evening news with your host, Mason Cooper.
Tonight on Hooper's Beta, overshadowed by the biceps brachii, unbeknownst for centuries if it had one or two muscular heads, this investigative report uncovers the mysteries of the brachialis. All right, so all jokes aside, there's a reason why we started this video off that way. Really, these injuries for the brachialis, especially traumatic ones, are pretty uncommon. In fact, a lot of the research studies that you'll read all start off like, an injury to the brachialis is quite uncommon. And then they'll finish by saying, more research should be done. But with that being said, we can extrapolate the information from the research that we have. We can apply what we know about the mechanics of it to climbing, the function it has in climbing, and then we can look at some of the rehab testing and how we can apply it to our training. All right, so we gotta start with the anatomy of it because honestly, if we understand this, we will quickly understand why this is so important for climbing. There are, in fact, two muscular heads. Now, we joked about that in the beginning, how like, you know, for centuries it wasn't known. It literally wasn't really confirmed until the 21st century when research reports came out that looked at cadavers and looked at the two different muscle heads and their attachment sites. Now with that, they were better able to understand the mechanics of it as well. So we know that there's a deep and a superficial head. The deep head, its prime function is actually to help initiate elbow flexion when we're in full extension. The superficial head is most active and helps the most with mid-range flexion. So it really helps stabilize the forearm in the mid-range for flexion. The final component with the two of them working together, they help prevent and control some of the rotation forces. So in a sense, it locks the elbow in. All right, so if you're paying attention to the anatomy and the biomechanics, you now understand like why this is helpful with climbing. So why talk about this now? Well, with a lot more of like the hangboard programs out there and the home training going on related to the quarantine, we may be setting ourselves up for like an overuse injury. So we're gonna talk about some of the risk factors and mechanisms of injury for the brachialis. The first one we're gonna talk about, which is really important, is simply not properly engaging your back or shoulder while you're doing any kind of pull motion. So as we mentioned, that deep head initiates flexion of the elbow. So if you're initiating all of your pull just from the elbow and not pulling from your back as well, you're not really sharing the load between the two sides and you may end up placing too much load on the brachialis. The second risk factor that we're gonna look at is doing too many like lock-off moves. So whether that be actually with climbing or on the hangboard, you wanna practice proper load management, not doing too many lock-offs too many days in a row. The third might be doing too many pull-up variations that involve that sustained elbow flexion. So like for example, Frenchies are one where you're sustaining a lot of flexion. That doesn't mean that Frenchie pull-ups are bad. Again, we talk about like load management, just not doing only Frenchies as your like new form of exercise is important. It's good to mix that up so we're not overloading the tissue. The fourth, and this is really important as well, is not controlling the end of your pull-up. So if you're getting really tired and at the top you're just kind of like letting yourself fall down really quickly, you're putting a lot of strain on the brachialis. So they've actually shown like with the research that the brachialis is really responsible for the control of the extension from the flex position. So as you imagine, you do your pull-up, you're going back down to the bottom of it. If you're not controlling that lengthening, that eccentric motion, it's putting a lot of stress on it. And they've actually postulated that one of the main mechanisms of injury is like an uncontrolled extension with resisted at the brachialis when the arm is in this pronated position or if it's going from supinated to pronated. So think if you're doing like ring pull-ups and as you lower back down, you're rotating out and not controlling it, that's a high risk factor. The fifth risk factor is just like your climbing style. So if you're all cave, all underclings, all side pulls all the time, then again, load management, you're probably doing too much on that brachialis, especially if you're complementing that with lots of lock-off training afterwards. And finally, the sixth is just making every day a biceps day. I know that a lot of us are bored out there and we're trying to get ready for the potential of, you know, that summer beach bod, but every day doesn't need to be a biceps day. Side note, related to the overuse, like the bicep every day thing, there's literally a case report, look down in the references, about this young athlete who was doing like bicep curls and pull-ups 6 days a week and developed myositis ossificans. So take your time with it. Don't overdo your bicep exercises. So what about symptoms with this? Now this is where it gets kind of complicated because oftentimes the research has shown that it's hard to differentiate between a distal biceps tendon injury and a brachialis injury, but oftentimes we'll report symptoms more kind of in that anterior mid portion of the arm, whereas a biceps brachii injury, the symptoms are usually more distal or at the shoulder. So this is where it gets hard if your symptoms are here, because it could be a wrist flexor injury, it could be that biceps brachii injury, or it could be the brachialis injury. The only real kind of clear symptom to differentiate it from is if you have more of that pain in the anterior mid portion, or if it's kind of just lateral or medial, that may be more indicative of brachialis injury. Patients with injuries to the brachialis often do not report a pop. So if you don't feel that, that doesn't mean you haven't like torn anything if you had a trauma, but that's not one of the commonly reported symptoms either. So if we don't have a lot of symptoms to go off of, how do we know if we have this injury or not? Well, that's where we look at some testing. So with testing, the best thing that we can understand is that the brachialis is kind of independent of position of the forearm, whereas like the biceps brachii, EMG studies have shown, can be differentiated by using the supinated position. So if we use like just an example, if we resist elbow flexion with our wrist in the supinated or palm up position, and that produces a ton of pain, and as we go to neutral or pronated and it's not really much pain, it may be more related to that biceps brachii. If you have pain pronated, neutral, and supinated, it could very well be the brachialis, because the biceps brachii will not be as active in those other two positions. So for testing, I recommend doing it in the pronated, neutral, and supinated position. Now the other thing you also need to do, and why you may have noticed I'm pushing from my forearm and not my wrist, is because if I push past my wrist, I'm going to be engaging the wrist flexors or those finger flexors which run up into that same site. So if your pain is here, you want to help differentiate that testing by pushing from the forearm and not from the wrist. All right, so treatment for a brachialis injury is quite different than a lot of our other muscles. We can't do a ton of just like self-massage to it because, as we mentioned, it is overshadowed. It is deep to the biceps brachii. You can try and get like a foam roller or a lacrosse ball and get some deep pressure in there, and if that seems to help, by all means, go for it. It's just a little more challenging than some of our other injuries we incur. You also can't really stretch the brachialis, so that's not gonna help with your rehab. You think about eccentric exercises. So we know from the research that the brachialis is one of the main controllers of eccentric elbow flexion. So it's very possible that doing some eccentrics, you know, whether it be supinated, neutral, or pronated, or all three of them, can definitely help with that brachialis injury. So it is possible, but you also have to think about what caused your injury. If this was an injury simple of like overuse and improper load management, then if you're gonna do those eccentrics, you need to balance it out. You need to take away some of the other training that you may be doing that's overloading that tissue. The big takeaway with the brachialis is load management. The body is like, it's amazing. It can adapt to all these crazy forces that we place on it. It just takes time, it takes balanced training, and it takes a smart approach to not just lead yourself into an overuse injury. I hope you guys have enjoyed this video. If you have any questions or comments, please write down below or hit that like and subscribe button. And until next time, train, train, and repeat. Perfect, but it could be better. If you don't know what it is, gonna learn today. Brachialis, fight it. Is this a good spot? Did I do it myself?
Yeah.
Wow.
Nice job.
First time.
You're learning.
The workhorse elbow flexor that is literally overshadowed by the biceps brachii is known as what?
Somebody?
Anyone?
Oh, come on.
Brachialis. Is that not a bad idea? It's kind of funny.
I like it.
What did I just say?
Did you black out again?
Yeah. Shadowed by the biceps brachii. Overshadowed. We're gonna talk in, are we in the 21st century now? The third, it can be like too many pull-up variations that involve sustain, okay. Well, that's where we look at some testing. Like that segue?
Yeah.
If we have an issue of, I liked where I was going before.
Being smart is gonna come off as too condescending.
Okay. Stay smart. Remember, staying, I wanna compliment the brachialis, you know?
Yeah.
It's a good one. Better?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, done?
I think so.
Oh, hey, you're still here. Jason, they're still watching.
Oh. Heyo.
Dude, say something cool so they like the videos and subscribe for more awesome content.
Like and subscribe for more super sweet vids, y'all.
So lame, dude. So lame.
I thought it was pretty good.